Fox and Friends, their relationship with Donald Trump over the past couple of weeks seems a little bit different. We'll get into a few of those examples in a bit. But the first has to do with his declaration yesterday that he's not interested in any more negotiations over COVID recovery funds. This is how this morning Brian Kilmeade responded to that stance by the president.
Hours meetings with Steve Mnuchin and the speaker, both have indicated that they both want to do a deal. For the president to come out with a tweet like that with the market still open, just crash the market and cost people a lot of money, knowing that an hour before Federal Chairman Jerome Powell put out this statement, they're warning that failing to inject more federal help into the economy would risk weakening the tenuous recovery. Yeah. The country needs stimulus checks, airlines needs help, and of course you have 30,000 people who are about to lose their jobs and be furloughed through no fault of their own. The tourist industry, the hospitality industry have been destroyed. If you work in a hotel, you don't need me to tell you that. So get the PPP program financed again. They have to find a way to work out this thing behind closed doors, because riding the markets, it does nothing but have people lose money and gets people extremely stressed. And with the market closed, the president says, let's do this again. I understand negotiating tactics, but not at this point. I actually think the president now has pressure, more pressure on him now than he had before his first tweet, because Nancy Pelosi clearly could turn around and say, well, it's not my fault, I was having talks. So it looks like the president's the one to blame now. But I don't know how he has leverage.
Yeah, but he is willing to, you know, people really want those $1,200 checks, and he is very specific. I will write the checks, Nancy, pick up the phone, let's do a deal. We will keep you posted. Who knows, maybe he'll be tweeting this morning during our show.
Yeah, who knows, maybe. Maybe there's a small chance he'll be tweeting. Maybe there's a small chance that you're speaking directly to him as you always do. So there was a little bit from Ducey there to try to like spin, well, yeah, but he says he wants the checks, even though again, chief of staff says he's done. He's not actually interested in any of that. But Kilmeade's like, come on, Trump, man, why are you doing this? I'm looking at my account right now and it's cratering. Come on, save me, bro. And Kilmeade was also the one a week ago who is like, come on, Trump or the white supremacist, just please say that you don't like the man.
But you know what, not even that. He's not even saying, please don't, and I can't, and oh man, why'd you do that? He's actually perplexed that Donald Trump is so idiotic that he keeps doing these things. He can't understand. He goes, how'd he get himself in this position? He puts himself in a position where he can't even negotiate, Greg. Now he's cornered in, and Nancy Pelosi has the leverage. Where's his leverage? Donald Trump is a horrible businessman. He's not good at negotiating. He's stuck in his own empty brain, and all he does is bounce around from side to side like a crazy person in a room. That's all that happens in Donald Trump's brain. He's not a negotiator. He's not a businessman. He doesn't know what he's doing.
Yeah, that much is clear. I don't know what you want. I mean, you remember like 2 weeks ago when Trump implied during a phoner to them that he's gonna come on every week, and Ducey says, well, hey, we haven't agreed to that. I really do wonder if this is like, they obviously want him to get reelected. I'm not gonna go, you know, like obviously they do, but I wonder if to some extent it is starting to get to them that he might not. Well, we're gonna talk about that a little bit later on, so let's not go too deep into that right now. We do have a lot of other stories to talk about though.
Sorry,
before
John,
we get to that.
Yeah. Okay.
No. Continue.
One small thing, because Ducey talked about the $1,200 checks and people are expecting that $1,200 in their bank account, and that'll be great and awesome for them. When was the first round of those $1,200 checks? April, maybe? May at the latest. And so if you just woke up from a coma and that you went into right after the $1,200 check hit your account, you would say, man, I missed out on the last several months of $1,200 checks every month, because it sounds like American people have been getting some kind of COVID relief through this whole time. No, that $1,200 check happened right then. Now suddenly, after these several months of Republicans and Republican pundits and conservatives talking about how much American people need to get up off of their butts and get back to work in the middle of a COVID filled arena, now suddenly they need these $1,200 checks as if they've been getting them. No, they've been denied any kind of relief that we've already paid for. This is American people's money. So we can we can keep talking about how, oh, these people expect their checks, but for the past several months, you guys have been talking about how much they don't deserve their checks. Just pointing that out for you. Let's not act like you've been on this right path this whole time. This whole time you've been against the American people. So stop acting like you're for them now because the business roundtable said so, and now President Trump is tanking the stock market and your little money that's involved in it. That's what your motivation is. You have no care about what the American people have gone through and the $1,200 checks that you think they deserve now. You really don't care. I'm tired of this narrative that you really give a damn about us.
I agree. Couldn't be clearer that they don't.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.